but she got more hours.
She went down to first clerk pay.
Right, correct, right. Which is pretty much what all the first clerks, I mean, I'm not saying.
So the reason she wanted to make it more is because she was actually running the department for a while.
Right.
So.
Yeah, and last year is a temporary adjustment, and I knew that. And I come in right at the budget time when all, basically they sat down on my first day and said, hey, you have a budget meeting tomorrow, like what? So, and honestly, like I said, I wanted to approach you guys, I know it's a tough time, I get that, so it doesn't hurt to ask either. She's a great asset in my department, she does a great job, so if it's not something that's feasible, then I ask you to please do and see what it would be, because she's very helpful.
Is there anybody that wants to move on from this? If not, we can just leave this for the cycle. And I.
I think a motion to adjust it for the district salary.
All right, a motion, is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion by Ethan Brown, seconded by Larry Stopper.
And the motion is?
Yeah, can you clarify?
To bring back her pay from the, you said it was from
Fourteen, her pay now is 14.29, I'm asking it to go to 15. And the 562, then it would finish up the rest of the year if we started this pay.
Just to clarify, that was her pay for running the department.
Correct, but I believe this is also COVID related too, I mean, she's done a lot more work during this whole COVID time too, correct? And I believe she just needs to be compensated for the work that she's doing.
The day-to-day operation, the bench room, the 60 phone calls a day, we have two staff. Me and her, so that's it, she does a lot of work.
I just can't go with that because everybody in this courthouse is going above and beyond because of COVID.
I don't disagree with that one bit, but I also believe you should take care of your staff, so. There's not a person in this courthouse that's not good staff, but I'm a firm believer that if you take care of your staff, they will stay with you, they will work hard for you. I've been like firm on that since I've been a supervisor. If not, you lose them, and then you start over, then you train somebody, and so that's, like I said, I understand that the budgets are tricky, so.
One way or another, but I want to clarify, you said COVID-19, you know, she did, and, but she did get her extra pay too during that time, so I just want to clarify.
Sure, absolutely.
Upfront.
Yeah, she got compensated for that.
I mean, I'll chime in like 2 cents. Anybody else ready? I mean, we go through the budget cycle for a reason. There are times that we have extenuating circumstances that, like the situation we had last year where somebody's workload would materially change. I think it's fair to say that everybody's workload would materially change. So for us to pick one and not another, it's pretty challenging for me.
Pretty challenging with a two-person staff as well. Keep that in mind when every other office has 5 or 6 people, so.
Not the treasurer.
And well, I mean, we have a lot of departments that have 2 people, so I mean, and so, you know, it's, we're 27 days from our first budget cycle hearing, or budget hearing. So, you know, I think that that's probably the most appropriate place to handle the salary component, which was the motion on the floor. And that can be debated, you know, alongside the merit of every other salary case at that, and that's what that hearing is for. So, that would be my input to vote no and handle this at budget cycle.
Josh, I would certainly concur with everything that was said. You know, being this council, we'd like to talk about when we discuss salaries, especially. And I'm fearful of the precedent that he set for every other employee in town.
And just making you know that she was, I mean, she did get paid for the COVID in there.
That's true.
So to throw COVID in there on top of that is not fair to me.
But,
I'm sorry.
No, none of the stuff I haven't heard, it has anything, just day-to-day operations, it don't have anything other than just sort of.
And Cameron, I certainly don't disagree with your comment about taking care of our employees. You know, if there was something that we could do for everyone, I think everyone on this council would. But I think timeliness and then, you know, picking one individual out and not giving everybody that.
Sure. Is there any other further discussion on the motion on the floor to increase the wage from $14.29 to $15? Yeah.
Well, she's the first clerk, correct? Is that, that's what I heard? So I think all the first clerks have established that salary. All the first deputy have that salary, as well as second deputy. So Cameron, perhaps the issue isn't her pay, but maybe you should look at, I'm suggesting, that maybe her classification is wrong. That's maybe the avenue you should take.
I read the request. Change the request.
Yeah, definitely. Is there any other discussion? All right, all those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
One vote in the affirmative. All those opposed, aye.
Aye.
I second the motion, but based on the discussion here, I believe no.
All right, so the motion failed 1-6. Doug, wait one second. We still have the transfer on the table. From the auditor's perspective, is there any reason to do it now versus the end of the year?
COVID
transfer, yeah.
I would prefer it even now so I can get the corrections done, because it's not just transferring. I would have to correct it from regular pay to the other, so.
So it's your preference to do it now?
Yes.
Okay.
So.
All right, I have a motion by Paul Ryder, seconded by Ethan Brown, to approve the transfers totaling, well,
hold on.
Well, that included a transfer for the.
No, it's broken down.
Well, but that includes the 5.6, the 26.4. So it would be.
The COVID is 27.791.
So 27.791, which is the 1856.1 for the executive director and the 2.4 for the first one. Are you tracking through that?
Yeah, it's got it.
Okay. And the transfer form has that coming from zoning ordinance.
Correct. That was a request of my area planning president.
Is there any discussion on the transfer? All right, all those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 7-0. All right, thanks, Cameron.
Thanks, Matt.
Valerie.
Good morning.
Morning.
I wanted to give you a little update on our new COVID procedures. Governor Holcomb's now mandated mask wearing. I did call the State House this morning to find out. I got a lot of questions this morning from employees. Do I have to wear it while I'm working in our office? We already have the face shields. I called the State House. They said they don't have anything in writing, and until they have it in writing, they won't give us an answer either way. But as we have already been doing, masks are required in the courthouse. That's what they stated. So we will continue with the requirement for the masks in the courthouse.
For visitors.
And the visitors, and so the employees, we are, you know, giving them to the employees in our offices. When we run short, they just need to know that the health department will be.
We have a sneeze guard shield.
Right.
I asked for guidance, whether they have to wear the mask at their desk, the employees here, from the State House. Are you requiring, since you're having a mandated mask order, are you requiring that they wear it at their desk in the courthouse? Or can they just use the face shield? This was not included.
So like when they leave, they have to put them on?
They, when they leave the office, they have to put them on, because it's now a requirement.
Courthouse or the office?
If you're leaving out of your cubicle, wherever they're working, because now they're not wearing them, is it required? That was my question. I haven't gotten the answer to that yet.
And you said leave the office, like we...
Like if I go to the restroom, I always put, I put my mask on.
Okay, so that's what you're wanting to require?
I'm asking if that's his requirement.
Okay.
I'm asking if that's the governor's requirement, because I can't make it, I can't loosen it as the preparedness and bioterrorism.
I was just trying to understand.
Yeah, I can make it tighter, and I don't want to make it restrictive for everybody here. If we've already spent the money for the sneeze guards, if they are 6 foot distanced, you know, and all that, so. I'm working on redoing the school, back to school protocols and plans that I've written. This will be the third time. So they are now requiring students to wear masks from grade 3 to 12. Unless I can social distance, it was 6 feet, now they're saying 3. So the new guidelines just came out yesterday. I emailed both superintendents, the nurses, requested a meeting to discuss the back to school plans. Purdue has now decided to take in-house classes out. First semester will be online.
When did that come down?
Just yesterday.
Oh, okay.
Since the new guidelines came out with government. So Purdue has changed. They're gonna do online first semester now. I have asked the superintendents what their thinking is, because some schools are pushing their opening back. Some schools have decided to do e-learning for the first semester. We weren't, but now with the new guidelines, parents, some parents don't want their children wearing masks, some parents do. We are requiring they wear a mask on the school bus. We can't mandate that, but now we can, because it's mandated mask for everyone. How do we police that? How do they do that? That's a new discussion that we have to go back to the table and read it.
I have a question about the younger ones. I mean, if they get in a school bus, do they have, they don't have to wear them either?
Yes.
They do. So they don't have to in school, but they have to on the school
because
bus.
They can't school, they can't social distance on the bus.
Okay.
Now, if in the classrooms, if we can social distance the younger ones at least 3 feet apart, then the governor's new guidelines, and I don't have it in writing yet because it hasn't been sent to us, and I think we'll get that, but.
Are we discussing having aides on the bus to be able to make this so our bus drivers are not distracted with all of this?
They are, at the, I will say our recent guidance that we wrote up, no, they did not. Now I have to go back to the table today with them and rediscuss having an aide on there. At the beginning, it was recommended they wear the mask, so we didn't require an aide on the bus. Now that he's mandated the mask and said that masks will be worn on school buses, now we have to go back and revisit that with the schools. So that's part of the thing, the plan that I'm talking about with the schools. And I just requested it this morning because I wanted to get more guidance after the meeting with Governor Holcomb, and he went on television and announced it. And now I need to rewrite the protocol and the plan with the schools.
You said something about 3 feet for the schools.
That's what, can we, it was 6.
Can this be 3 feet?
I know. I every day it changes.
I'm a little kid.
They can't
see
as far.
Maybe if you're a little child.
Their bodies are smaller.
I said, yeah.
The one that's there. Yeah.
I mean, it's you know, like drinking from a fire hose. It changes moment to moment. And I was just on a webinar on Tuesday about the new guidelines, for quarantine and how that's gonna change. So my guidelines at the school on their quarantine is different, and now the state has changed the quarantine guidelines. So we have to go back and change that protocol also. So,
Continually moving parts?
Yeah, I mean, you can tell us all this in 24 hours, it's gonna change.
I know, and.
Fiscally, does this change anything for us?
Yeah, money-wise.
Yeah, I mean, we can talk about how irritation is till the cows come.
Right. The new nursing home guidelines that, you know, I've got them going, now they can see people for 4 hours. And, the fiscal part of it is, I talked with my board of health on Tuesday, and, or last Thursday, I guess. And the state is wanting us to set up a COVID testing site for Carroll County. They're gonna give us $50,000, which seems like a lot of money, but they want us to do it for 36 hours a week, starting September 1st and running through June 21st, 2021. So 10 months for 36 hours and 5 hours on Saturday, so 36 hours. $50,000. I don't have space for it, because we don't have an EOC. We don't have a building that Mike and I can totally work out of that we could do a testing site through. So we have to rent something. We have to have utilities. We have to pay people to do it, because they want at least 3 people to run the testing site. So most of the counties denied it. So they went back to the table. Now they're offering us $100,000. Even at $100,000, we're still almost $6,000 over budget for 10 months. So we're revisiting that. So now I have a proposal with White County. Can we merge? Maybe White County, Carroll County go together. So a lot of counties are trying to do that. The state's trying to ask us more questions about what sites we would have, how much it would cost. I don't have those numbers yet, because this just happened Tuesday. So we don't have the numbers. And Mike and I can't even, you know, we're trying to put our heads together to find a place. I'm trying to partner with a family health clinic to do it, because they're already open on Saturdays, but since they're Purdue, they don't really want to involve the county with it. So there's a lot of things I've got to do with that. So fiscally, I don't think it's possible at $100,000, because I don't want to go over and ask for county money for that. And we don't know what the projections are yet. A lot of the states are wanting to do this, and a lot of counties want to do this, but it's part of the CARES Act money that they're going to give us to do this. So right now I've got to run numbers and see if it's...
Does White County have a testing facility currently?
They have a hospital. They do not have a current testing site. So they are looking at the fire station, the old fire station that they have here. They're trying to partner with the hospital, but the hospital's IU, and IU doesn't really want to do another testing site.
Because most of them that I've seen is a trailer. And you drive up underneath a tent and a trailer, and...
That's a lot of the state drive-through ones, and
yeah.
What the state's wanting to do now is they want to back away from the state doing the testing.
And
have the counties do the testing.
Yeah.
And there's just a lot of, you know, they'll supply the PPE, they'll supply the equipment to do, you know, the swabs and everything else, but it's hiring.
And we have to think about weather. Like, it's going to be a winter month, long winter month to do a drive-through. I mean, how are we going to get people, you know, how are we going to set up? And I don't have a trailer big enough to do a testing site out of it.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You have to have a trailer, or you have to
build it. I mean, it's a big expense. So it's something that we're looking into. It's not something we're going to give into. My Board of Health said no for $50,000. I have to take it back to the Board of Health for $100,000 with the numbers. So that's kind of where we're at right now. And like I said, the nursing homes are working. And so I went to my Board of Health, my position as bioterrorism preparedness coordinator was a part-time position, and with requirement of 12 hours a week to 16 hours a week. Now it's pretty much a full-time position trying to redo all of this. I have my new grant started. I started on my new grant July 1st. And I have my new grant agreement here.
What that be all for COVID also?
Well, it's also going to be reimbursed. Not reimbursable. Mine's not reimbursable because mine's paid for the grant. So it's already on the grant here. So I can't add my hours as COVID pay for.
It's not county money.
Yeah, because it's not county money. My grant is from the federal government, given to the state, and then they supply. So it's not county money. I can't put my time into it for the CARES Act. It's already government money. So that's
all my. All paid for by the grant.
She's paid out the grant.
No cost.
I know she's paid out the grant, but if she's only supposed to work 4 hours a week and say she's putting in 40, she's just not getting paid for the rest of that then?
No, I am. I am.
She put in for more than that through the state, that the county didn't have to pay it, the state.
I have, okay, so last year they gave me 25,000. If you go to my grant. Last year my grant was 25,000. They've increased it to 31,895, which is actually $400 more than I was supposed to, that my previous budget was sent to me. So they gave me another 400,000. So when I budgeted my money for last year, I didn't start until August, so I had already started after the grant had started July 1st of last year. I started in August. So if my pay was set at $12 an hour, which has been that way for a couple of years, because you didn't have a preparedness coordinator, so nobody increased the pay, right? But with my increased hours and the increased, this is what my deliverables were last year. They put a suspension on my deliverables from last year so I could focus on the COVID. So now this year, where it says the attachment A, those are deliverables I have to meet for the grant money. And then I have eight deliverables from this year that I have to add into that. Plus, now they've asked me to do a COVID tracing testing class through Purdue. So my workload has increased. There's seven classes that are required on the attachment A, plus this global Purdue class. So I'm asking for an increase in my preparedness salary. The my Board of Health asked for an increase to $16 an hour. My grant agreement gives me $19,000 for salary. And my grant is completely fluid. It's not a line item. I can move my lines back and forth. If I don't have enough money in for equipment, I can take it from somewhere else and move it. It's just $31,895, period. It's totally refundable to the county. No county money is ever paid for my salary. And the workload has just totally increased, hundredfold. I mean, I never thought, and Tracy asked me, did you expect, as a preparedness coordinator to have a pandemic, you'd be doing this? Yeah, I did. I didn't expect it was going to last 2 years. In all the training we've ever done, all the exercises we've ever done. You're going to go in, you're going to set it up, you're going to run people through, you're going to close it down, you're going to do NIMS, the NIMS that we do for the EMA director and I do, all the paperwork, and we're done. We didn't know this pandemic was going to go on and on. We're going to back up, we're going to go forward. We got to write the rules, change the rules, write the protocols, change the plans. I had no idea going into this that's what was going to entail. So I'm asking for the increase in my salary as the state has allowed.
So will the state's contribution to your salary continue?
Yes.
And what does the state pay? Whatever we pay you? Or?
The state pays me. The state has agreed to $19,000 a year for my pay.
Okay.
However, I'm under a salary ordinance with council.
Right.
No.
Oh, I'm
not on not on the salary ordinance.
Mm.
Because it was a grant.
Mm. Okay. I was told I was on the salary ordinance for the council. That's
well if the county didn't make any dollars, no restrictions on the grant, you wouldn't be.
Even like community projections, that was because it's a grant and I was told that.
did budget a lot for PPE, so your, the amount of PPE that you've had to pay for is not gone for the preparedness. It's all been from Mike and his EMA, because he did not know at the beginning of this that he was gonna have to get PPE for the fire, for the police, for the EMS, because it was all through me. But the state turned around and changed that. I started giving PPE to the fire, to the EMS, and to the law enforcement, and then ISDH, and then Mike's EMA sector decided it was gonna be split, and Mike had to come up with PPE, and I had PPE. So I had things I wasn't gonna use, like boot covers and Tyvek suits and hoods that he needed. So we kind of just, I said, just take that, because it was old PPE I had stockpiled before and I wasn't gonna use it. And we didn't wanna have to purchase it. So Mike and I worked well, really well together for this. And
once again, that we're back to the COVID stuff that is gonna be reimbursed to the state, whether it be through you or the EMA. My question is, what if we still didn't have you? Who would be handling all this? It would be Mike at EMA. Mm-hmm. So I'm just saying, you keep saying all these things, but this is all going to be reimbursable from the state.
Not my PPE.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If we didn't have you, it would be all reimbursable through EMA.
Right, but since you have the grant for preparedness and the state has already given you money for PPE through preparedness,
correct,
you can't ask for that money. You can't re-ask.
You can't grant off a grant.
Yeah. You can't take that money.
Which is
but EMA and
right.
But his
something else out of the grant and then run all that through that.
Exactly. Why are we running it through her when it's not reimbursable, when it could be reimbursable through your EMA?
Because the state says that the health department has to have preparedness for their health department to run through all your health practitioners, like the eye doctors, the dentists, the chiropractors, the one doctor's office here that we have, the clinics.
So
they did
do when we didn't have those. For the couple of years that we didn't have this.
We didn't have it. We had it. We didn't pay anybody for it. Joyce and I did it between.
So you covered it.
We covered
they
it.
Covered
so
the
didn't they
got,
lose the money.
They got the $15,000.
That's where a lot of the supplies were stockpiled when we were doing it.
Okay.
And then
I stockpiled stuff from like 2009. That's what we started with. And then I bought
more. So you're
more.
Saying your grant will cover the $16 an hour carries?
Yes. But I'm already working on my budget.
Well, she works off of July to July. She doesn't have a hard budget.
Her grant runs July to July.
She's not a budget item for you.
Right. So isn't this more a health department? I mean,
she's just coming to give you the lesson.
Yeah.
I'm just telling you what's going on. I was told I needed to come to the council.
I'll shoot Eric an email and just verify.
The Board of Health already approved it.
I think the state wants the council to approve it too.
I don't understand why, because we have nothing to do with it.
Well, because we were under the.
She still gets a county check, even though it's not county money.
Right, it's written through the county, and then you're reimbursed.
So
that's it's
fluid. I believe it's just like McKee being with the Community Corrections budget when she was director. She just asked for the blessings.
Right.
Not to be safe, let's just do a consensus or a non-consensus.
We
just
have
it in the minutes.
We had to have the blessing of the council to get the money. So.
To do
well,
the grant.
Have that blessing.
Yeah.
Right.
The commissioners or the council to do the grant also. So that's where that was at.
Right.
And is this the same situation with Dr. Vedder? I mean, I know he's on here.
No, he's
no,
it's not. He's a budgeted.
He's a budgeted. Okay.
Yeah. So,
he's on here. If you want a consensus.
That's coming next.
You want a motion?
Yeah, let's just do a motion.
I move
Valerie, well, we really don't even need, I mean, so have you done the application?
Yeah, it's already signed.
And it's approved.
It's approved.
At $16 an hour.
$19,000.
Yeah, so all we have to do is.
Everybody just needs to say, I give you my blessing.
Well, we just, we.
It's not per hour, it's the $19,000.
Right, so we.
She's just saying.
Right, so we just need a motion to approve their grant.
Okay.
So moved.
All right, so motion by Paul Ryder, is that you?
Sorry.
Motion by Paul Ryder, second by Ethan Brown. Is there any discussion on the approval of the EMA grant? Or not EMA, excuse me, the bioterror.
Bioterrorism?
Yeah.
That's.
Goodness.
People are, what are you again?
Bioterrorism preparedness grant.
Yes, preparedness.
Easy for me to say.
And then I was asked by Dr. Goddard to bring forward his.
Well, we got to vote.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. So is there any discussion on the approval of grant? All those in favor, aye?
Aye.
Pose same sign. Motion carries seven zero.
Then I was asked by Dr. Goddard, we had our Board of Health meeting, he requested from the Board of Health to increase his salary to $25,000 a year due to all the extra work that he's had to do through this pandemic. The board approved his salary to increase it to $25,000. Board of Health, from 17. And, which is about average for what health officers get in the state of Indiana. I mean, Benton County is not as big as us, so theirs is a little lower. I think theirs was $20,000, close to that. So he's asked for me to bring this forward to the.
I speak for Board of Health. It's just like everybody else. It's not a part-time job. He has to take some part-time. Field of press releases, telephone calls, almost not 24/7, but probably 18 hours a day at all.
And he's an exempt employee right now, and he's asked for non-exemption, is that right?
So he didn't get any extra COVID pay, is that what?
Yeah, I'm not too clear, I'll be honest.
Well, that's not because of the exempt. That's because he was not in the building. You had to go to work, come in, and that's what we were told.
He's a salary.
We did meet with him one or two times a week at his office. Joyce and I went over there, sat down with him, had a meeting with him about what was transpiring with COVID. But we went to his office to do it. And he had to have a lot of paperwork had to be signed and moved around.
Did other department heads get COVID tech? No, no.
Well, department heads, some did.
Not if they were exempt and not if they were elected officials.
That's different than a department head. What I say is a department head, others are elected officials, they're not included in that, the department heads.
No other exempt employees, or exempt, or what's the other word?
Non-exempt.
No, we just changed that.
Oh.
But.
I know what you're saying.
Excluding, no other exempt or non-exempt, no exempt or excluded employee got COVID pay, right?
Clarify that.
You as department head, you have paid COVID.
I am an elected official. I did not, all elected officials did not, but there were some department heads that probably did get any.
So like the ones that janitor would get COVID pay, or is that what you're saying? But he's a salary, he's not a salary employee. He's an hourly employee.
You asked me, you asked me.
No, no, I'm being serious.
I did, you know, some department heads.
But he's, but the difference is he's a, the janitor is an hourly employee.
They're not salary.
And Dr. Goddard is exempt, salary employee.
Go ahead, Richard.
Yeah.
Okay, just that the county has to have a health officer that is an MD in the county. And if you don't have Dr. Goddard, we're going to have to hire out of county to come to Bureau County to do that, which would cost the county
not, that he has.
Other hours.
Put in the extra work. What? I would think some of this money probably could come back.
There's other doctors that live in the county, they just don't work in the county.
Ben Anderson.
The only practicing one in the county.
We have residents that live here, but work in other counties.
Residents are there. Dr. Anderson, what is he?
Dr. Ray. There's a doctor that lives out of, works out of Louisville Memorial, lives in the county.
He's a resident, but works in Cass County.
Once again, I'll interject that everybody is affected by COVID. This is a budgeted position. We are so close to budget. My preference is to discuss it at budget time and bring it back at that time.
Are you okay with losing it?
I strongly disagree.
No, did I say that?
Well, I mean, that's the.
Did I say I'm okay with losing it? No, I said.
We're being leveraged? Well, I did just, yeah.
Let me rephrase what I said exactly. Everybody has been affected by this COVID, not just certain people. This is a budgeted position. We are within days of going to the budget. I prefer to go to the budget. No, I did not say that I was okay with leaving.
Sorry, I need to swing around here. So we have no motion on the floor.
I'd make a motion to raise the bid.
I have a motion by Easton Brown, seconded.
Well, I don't think we can do that. You're on.
I don't think that's a conflict. We all of us said on the words that are appointments from this.
Is it just a paper? It is, and I'm not saying that will be a rebel again, but it's because, well, yes. But if he is the president of the health board, who had okayed this request.
I say I'm not with it, I guess.
That's what I was told when I was asked, like, I'm on the Great Delphi Chamber Board, that they would assume that I would not make any decisions or vote with that.
I guess the way to 100% know for sure, but I'm just guessing.
Your prerogative, Don.
I'll withdraw my second.
All right. Is there anyone who would like to second the motion, Councilman Brown? Motion dies from lack of second. Thanks, Valerie. Hey, Valerie, appreciate all your work. Thank you very much. Okay, we have four additionals that have been advertised. I would like to hear the EMS separately, or EMS and highway separately. Doug, can you speak to your vehicle purchase?
You didn't do one on the agenda. The declaration of fiscal body.
Oh, we did miss one. Okay, I'll come back. Yes, sir, please.
Since the last time we talked, I've given you the EMS place vehicle sheet. I did make copies this morning, but everything really stayed the same except for I have found on a lot down in Indianapolis, a Dodge Durango. Somebody had ordered a big vehicle and backed out of the deal. So that is the absolute only vehicle I've been able to find that's a 2020 that's on the lot. It's available for purchase. It is right at $31,000. Around $35,000 if I order a traverse from Frank Bacon. It's going to be about $35,000 if I order one. My concern about ordering anything is if it gets ordered and things get shut down again, it can be months before a vehicle is found. So I would like to go ahead with this Durango. Since it's out there, it's available.
So what's the entire docket now with $31,000 price point?
You mean the whole thing?
Yep.
The whole thing is the vehicle's $31,000, but then you have the Surface Pro, the radio switchover, all that stuff. So the total cost was $43,322. We've got the insurance settlement. We got that check, right? And that was was for like $18,422.21. I'm gonna pay $5,300 out of my radio budget to put a new radio in it, so an additional radio we're adding. So total county cost would be right around $19,531. That would come out of the actual. $19,531.79.
So Beth, from a logistical standpoint, what's the best manner to get the money in the line? If we can avoid putting a $50,000 additional out there, actually funding.
I have kept that check to deposit because I wasn't sure what your plan is, where you're going to take it from. So if you take it from King County, I would advertise it, which that's where the commissioners have asked for, what we have to talk about. But anyway, with that county general, but I advertise it from King County, because that's where the issues have come from. I can receive that money in the King County, and it will go away. And then I have, it's not a traditional, so I can put it in that line.
So does the motion just need to be to approve the $19,531 as additional?
I would go with a full amount in that way, I would do that. That way that includes the tax.
The motion would be for that in King County, not out of the high, or not out of line of.
Right. I put the fund number here and put me in as just so you know what it was.
Okay, well, I
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
I got you. I would like for you to round that up though, because additional is even, so it makes sense. Round it up or?
Well, it says $50,000 on here, that's what I was saying, so is it $44,000?
$43,000, but if you did $44,000, that should be, that could be $700 in future.
So, is there a motion for the $44,000?
So moved.
Motion by Paul Ryder to approve $44,000 out of King County. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Scott Ayers. Is there any discussion? All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 7-0.
Scott.
Yeah, Paul Ryder, Scott. The next item is.
You want to go back to Doug?
Oh, yes. Yeah, let's do that. Thanks, Doug.
Yep, thank you.
Hey, is he all right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's good. It's about 2 weeks to get over his soreness.
Oh,
okay.
This is a declaration of fiscal body for the Camden Library. We just have to approve their budget.
You're just approving them. I mean, they declared that you're the fiscal body for them, so we would have to approve their budget.
Right. I would get a motion to go ahead and sign this on council's behalf.
Second.
Motion by Travis Martin, seconded by Paul Ryder. All those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 7-0. Okay, so we have three additionals on for the highway department for repairs, building and equipment, land, and road materials. These have all been discussed at previous council meetings. Would anybody like to be handled as one, or would anybody like them pulled apart to discuss?
Let's do it as one.
Okay.
I just got a question on this land acquisition.
Yep.
Where is this, the $100,000 going to come from?
It's advertised out of the highway, motor vehicle
be the same.
And this would be an additional one, or is this just authorization to spend it? Because they got pretty good balance, that's what I'm.
Yeah, this is, so we advertised it last month, and this would be, this vote would allow them to spend that $111,000.
To spend.
To acquire.
To come out of money that's in that balance.
It's, yes.
So then.
Second.
All right, so, and that's for all three, correct, Paul?
Yes, sir.
I have a motion by Paul Ryder, seconded by Larry Stoffer, to approve three additionals, totaling $154,000 for County Highway. Is there any discussion? All right, all those in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries 7-0.
I have a resolution for you to sign.
This is resolution to, yes.
Resolution 2020-106.
Yep. We have three additionals that have been requested for advertisement. 911 for $8,000 of the repairs and maintenance line, and two on the jail project, one for utility easement, and the other for the preparation of bid documents, and I assume that's